We're exactly 4 weeks out until voters head to the polls, and a lot is on the line. Inside Politics anchor John King joins us now with a closer look at the latest polls. John?
Wolf, the midterm vote 4 weeks from today, four Tuesdays from today, and these brand new CNN polling numbers showing Democrats have a very favorable climate heading in to the final stretch. Let's take a look at the numbers. A double-digit lead when we ask Americans, likely voters, which party will you support when you vote in your local congressional election? 54% of likely voters now say Democrats. 41% say Republicans. A double-digit lead for the Democrats. If that holds up for 4 weeks, if that is the case on Election Day, it's almost guaranteed the Democrats will pick up the 23 seats they need to take back the House, probably more than that. Also, would keep the Senate in play if it stays in double digits. That's a much tougher climate for the Democrats, but a double-digit advantage tells the Democrats we still have a chance in these Senate races. Now, remember the 41. Midterm election years are about the president and his approval rating. 41% of the country says it will vote Republican for Congress. Guess what? 41% is the president's approval rating in our new poll. The president is underwater. That is hurting his party when it comes to congressional elections. Let's take a look at the history here. Go back to 2010. Democrat Barack Obama, the president of the United States, 45% at this point, 4 weeks out. 44% on Election Day. His party takes a beating in the Senate and especially in the House. Republicans take charge. That's a reminder to this president. If you are below 45, you're in trouble, as President Trump is. The second Bush midterm, 2006, same dynamic, 39% 4 weeks out, 43% on Election Day, a shellacking for the Republicans, losing 6 seats in the Senate, 30 seats in the House. Democrats take power in the House. A reminder again, this president is lower than President Bush was. And back to 1994, President Clinton at 42%, about where President Trump is, 4 weeks out. He got up to 44% in the Election Day exit polls, but still another shellacking. The Republicans took 8 seats in the Senate. Democrats lost 52 seats in the House, the Republican takeover, the Republican revolution, because of that. So the president now, this president at 41%, only 41% say they plan to vote Republican for Congress. 28 days, Wolf, is a long time. But right now, the president's party's in trouble. The Democrats optimistic heading into the stretch.
Yeah, early voting already starting in some places. John King, thanks for that explanation. On the ballot in November, 4 weeks from today, 36 governor's races, 35 Senate seats, and all 435 seats in the House of Representatives. Joining us now, Utah Congressman Chris Stewart. He's a Republican. He's a key member of the House Intelligence Committee. Congressman, thanks so much for joining us.
Good morning. Good to be with you.
Is the Kavanaugh fight the rallying point that Republicans needed to keep up with, clearly, there's been a growing Democratic voter enthusiasm?
Yeah, it's really made a difference, Wolf, and I can see it from talking to folks back home and talking to people around the country. And, you know, I've been on your show a number of times. I don't think I'm bombastic. I try to be level-headed. But I can tell you, I have never been as angry over politics as I was in watching these hearings. And not just for Mr. Kavanaugh, but for Dr. Ford as well. You ask yourself, why didn't Dianne Feinstein do this and release this information so it could be treated seriously? Why did they leak her name when she didn't want it to be leaked? Why did they force her into the circus when she had the option of being questioned privately? And then look at some of the things said about Justice Kavanaugh. I mean, the most outrageous accusations, multiple episodes of gang rape, said that millions of Americans would die. And I think most Americans watch this, and I think they just shook their head, and I know that many conservatives did. It really did stir up a lot of emotion and anger.
The president, as you know, he's calling the claims by Catherine Blasey Ford, her supporters, Democrats largely. He says it's all a hoax perpetrated by the Democrats. Our new poll shows that the president's approval rating among women nationwide is just 34% approved compared to 52% among men. How do Republicans, Congressman, combat what clearly seems to be a major gender gap?
Yeah, I think we do it by trying to be fair about this, by saying, as most of us have said, in fact, all of us have said, that I'm aware of, has said, look, if someone has accusation of this, they needed to be treated fairly. They need to be listened to. They need to be given the support and the legal structure around them so that those accusations are taken seriously and investigated. But at the same time, you can still protect the rule of law. You can still protect this idea that we've had for going on 1,000 years, going back nearly to the Magna Carta, that someone has a right to face their accuser and that we are presumed innocent, not just based upon an accusation, but the presumption of innocence would prevail. And those aren't mutually exclusive, Wolf. You can do both of those. I think most fair-minded Americans realize you have to do both of those. And I think if we make that argument, whether you're a man or a woman, whether you're a conservative or Democrat, black or white, regardless, most Americans will look at that and say, that is a fair approach to take in these circumstances.
We'll see the impact of this so-called gender gap. We'll see what the impact is 4 weeks from today. Let me get your quick reaction while I have you, Congressman, to the resignation of the U.S. ambassador to the U.N., Nikki Haley. Yeah. A total surprise for so many of us, including top officials in the Trump administration, including the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo himself. What does this mean from your perspective to the administration and its foreign policy?
Well, President Trump has an extraordinary foreign policy team around him. Again, Mike Pompeo, a good friend of mine, we served together on Intel, General Mattis, you look at the National Security Advisor, the CIA Director, and Nikki Haley was an important part of that team. It is surprising that in this day, she actually held this very close to her vest. It wasn't leaked and it wasn't talked about. I can tell you she's going to be missed. I don't know a single person, Republican or Democrat, who doesn't respect and genuinely admire her. She's been so strong on putting America's interests before the UN, putting America's interests before the world at large. I wish she would stay just because I have so much respect for her, but I think that she feels like there's other things that she can do. I certainly appreciate that. I look forward to seeing who the new ambassador will be and hopefully someone who's as extraordinary as Ms. Haley has been.
We'll see, hopefully we'll see fairly soon who that nominee is going to be. While I have you, I also want to get your thoughts. You're on the Intelligence Committee, Congressman. You saw the New York Times report that former Trump campaign deputy chairman Rick Gates was actually during the campaign considering hiring an Israeli firm to create false online identities to help then candidate Donald Trump hurt his Republican rivals, especially Senator Ted Cruz, who was a leading Republican candidate, eventually hurt Hillary Clinton in the presidential campaign. What are your thoughts about this proposal? It was never implemented, but they were willing to consider creating these false online personas.
Yeah. Look, I think virtually every campaign has had proposals put before them, and some of them included this. I can assure you that Hillary Clinton was given proposals with much of this same information or these ideas in it. I think every presidential candidate, most federal campaigns are. But the bottom line is they didn't do it. They, in fact, indicated they were not interested in it. So I don't think it's a meaningful story. I really don't. I don't think we'll be talking about this in a week or a month. It just seems to be many campaigns have considered this, have had these proposals. They rejected it. And I don't know what else we'd say about it.
Well, they were seriously considering creating these fake identities to try to influence the Republican National Convention because they wanted to hurt then one of the front runners, Ted Cruz. Even the fact that they were considering it and using a foreign company to get involved in domestic American politics, that doesn't bother you?
Well, I don't know that we know that they were considering it. I mean, as I read the story and as I understand this, this was a proposal that was given to them and they rejected it. And again, I'm just a little old congressman, but I have people propose things to me all the time that I realize that's not a good idea. I don't want to do that. And I think that was their response to this proposal.
Congressman Chris Stewart, thanks as usual for joining us.
Yeah, always, Wolf. Thank you.